In the second episode of Filtron Views, I'm talking to bassist and cellist Jennifer Vincent. We played together in KJ Dennard's band. She also joined me for a very exclusive performance in 2018 at the Swiss Residence in New York. Shortly before COVID-19, we started working on a track for the album Transit Net. We talk about her musical journey, the recent wildfires in her home state, Oregon, as well as the US election and the Black Lives Matter movement.
You seem to be very busy these days. I don't think anybody can take that for granted at this point, right?
No.
So you were just playing with Orrin Evans this past weekend?
Yes, just yesterday. Yeah, I got to do it with the guitarist Marvin Sewell. He plays jazz guitar, but he's like a slide master. He gives this like gutsy, bluesy tinge to his playing. It's really amazing. It's very original. Me and Marvin and Orrin and Camille Gaynor, the drummer, we were supposed to be the last quartet for the last patio series. But then Orrin decided, let's just make it a whole festival. So he booked four other bands right before us. And one of the bands included Buster Williams and Jeff Tane Watts and Orrin playing trio. So I got to see Buster Williams play, and he played this incredible solo version of a selection from Sketches of Spain. Sean Jones, the trumpet player, he played right before us. He played this hymn at the end of one of his songs, and like all the audience was in tears. There were a lot of people there, and they were socially distanced. So it was like a very moving time for musicians to be together.
You're originally from Oregon. What's going on there with the wildfires has probably occupied your heart and mind a lot the last couple of weeks.
Yes.
So can you talk a little bit about that? Where actually were you born in Oregon?
Salem, Oregon. It wasn't affected burn-wise, but it was very affected smoke-wise and ash-wise. Both my sister and mom had to pack up. My sister lives in Eugene, and both of them had to pack up to be ready to evacuate. Hmm. And they never got the evacuation order, but pretty much everyone in the Willamette Valley area and the Cascade Mountain Range had to pack up in order to be ready to evacuate. Most of the fires happened slightly east of the Willamette Valley and south, where the forests are. There's a few towns like Detroit and Mill City that were damaged. I mean, you know, just burned down. Quite a few towns are no more. It got to the point where nobody that I knew back in Oregon and Northern California and parts of Washington that I knew, including all of my family, could breathe normally. Like their eyes were hurting, they were having headaches all the time. Mm. And thank goodness, I think it was last Thursday, the rain started. When I was growing up, Oregon was like a rainforest climate. That's one of the reasons why Oregon is so lush and gorgeous and green, is because it has a lot of rain. Now it's semi-arid. In the last 20 years, the climate has gradually changed to a semi-arid climate.
Can you talk a little bit about how you came to music? You play bass, but you also play cello.
This is a very easy question, only because both my parents are musicians, and they met at the Seattle Symphony. So they met there, ended up moving to Salem, Oregon, because my dad got a job with the state. My first instrument was, I was 1 year old. It was beer bottle and egg slicer. So I had a one-man band. I sang, and I'd go, la, 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 bring, bring, like that. And I would make up songs with those three instruments. Yeah, like I had the band till I was like 2 and a half. And then I think my mom had me play violin when I was in fifth grade, I think. And she was a violin teacher, so she was my teacher. And it was really annoying to have my mom be my teacher.
That's
like, that didn't last very long. Like, I did that for like a year. But she had me take piano lessons. So I took some classical piano lessons for my godmother, Mary Johnson. Then when I was 11, she had me play cello.
Yeah. How did the transition to jazz start?
My dad had a couple Monk records, like the Thelonious Monk Big Band. Oh, I remember. I was at Fred Meyer. Now, this is seriously my transition to jazz. I was looking for like Cheap Trick albums and Def Leppard, you know, like the pop of that day, pop and heavy metal and stuff. And I saw this record, and there was this really cute guy in black and white, and he had his hands like this. He was like, had a very serious look on his face. I'm like, wow, this guy's really cute, and he looks very intense. He had very intense eyes, and it was John Coltrane. And so I bought the John Coltrane album, and I listened to it, and I really liked it. I was like, this is really cool. Then somebody said, oh, get My Favorite Things. That's the best one. And I'm like, okay, cool, because I like Julie Andrews and Sound of Music. So I got that, and it put me in a trance, and I would sit in my room and go, gong, 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 gong. Gong, gong, gong. But I would like strum it on my cello for like hours and put myself in a trance.
Oh, on the cello, right.
Okay. A middle school big band needed a bass player. Grant Hagestad, the director, knew I played cello, so he gave my mom an electric bass and said, here, have Jennifer learn how to play this. And so I learned how to sight read the notes on an instrument tune in fourths. I didn't improvise or anything. I didn't know about jazz, really. And then at the very end, I had heard this ending before. It goes da-da-da-da-da-da-da. I had heard that before on some other albums that my dad would play at home. And so at the end of this one song, I put that ending at the end of the song just for fun. And then everybody freaked out. So then I was at Oberlin as a classical cello major after high school. And so this one guy, who's a chemistry major, he stole an acoustic bass out of the education department and dragged me into a practice room and taught me rhythm changes, threw chord changes at me. Fingering, because it's tuned in fourths, made a lot more sense to me than something tuned in fifths. B flat, G, D, F. I didn't have to move my hand, didn't have to shift around and do all this fancy stuff they had to do on the cello. It's all right here, and oh, I hear the progression. It made total sense to me, and from that moment on, that's what I wanted to do. After Oberlin, I went back to Portland for a year to hang out on the jazz scene. Then I moved up to Montreal to give cello one more shot.
I love that city.
So I went to the Conservatoire de Musique for 1 year, and I studied with Dennis Brott, and I was in a couple chamber groups. Then after that year was over, again, I was just like so drawn to the bass that I went back to the bass again.
Betty Carter, Patti LaBelle, how did you come to work with those great singers?
My boyfriend, Alex Norris, of the time, he was in Betty Carter's Jazz Ahead program. And I went to SOB's to see their concert. Eric Rivas, the bass player who was playing with Betty at the time, he's like, hey, Eric, my girlfriend plays bass. Can she play one? Eric's like, okay, sure. So Betty was singing to the audience. Alex pulled me up onto the stage and Eric gave me his bass. You know, he's like this big guy and I'm like 5'3", and he's like 6'3". He hands off the bass to me. Betty turns around. She's like, oh my God. And I asked her if I could be in her Jazz Ahead program. So I did that for 2 years, and then she would hire me to do various things like clinics here and there. We did a concert at Birdland. We did some stuff with the Blue Note. Patti LaBelle was part of After Midnight, and that was more recent.
Okay.
That was in the Broadway show in 2013. Affiliated with Lincoln Center, and then Wynton Marsalis put it together.
Right. What's going on with the election politically, with the protests, Black Lives Matter? How do you think that's going to affect our life in general?
I have a lot of friends who have differing opinions from me.
Right.
Politically, they're simply wonderful people, and when we do talk about other political side, we kind of try to do it in a joking way, so it's kind of lighthearted, because I'm not going to change their mind. I knew a few of the people that came to the festival yesterday, and I know that they have very differing political opinions from me, and they were still there enjoying it. Nobody made them feel like they shouldn't be there.
Yeah.
Politics weren't mentioned. On the other hand, I am hoping that a lot of art and music will be made out of making a political statement out of this era, because I just think there's a lot of things that are extremely important to address. And I think that, like, Bob Marley keeps coming to my head. Mm. I didn't know anything about the politics that were going on back then, but he was a great unifier. We could use a Bob Marley right about now.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Out of your experience, what if you say you know a lot of people that are probably going to vote for Trump, do you think the divisiveness is not as big as they make it out to be in the media? Do you think that's hyped up by the media?
I think that the people that watch stuff that's much more right-wing and fringe than Fox are the ones that just won't listen. I know a lot of friends of mine who we have very similar political opinions, but they think that all Trump supporters are racist and stuff. People have different experiences throughout the country. People in Alaska, they don't see black people very often. So they're not seeing firsthand the discrimination that's going against them. People out in the Pacific Northwest, left-wing, fringe people, they think that Black Lives Matter is some kind of terrorist Marxist thing. They have these very twisted ideas because people are putting these ideas in their head. It's not based on fact. The people that support Black Lives Matter, they can't necessarily identify with what they're seeing firsthand. I think Black Lives Matter should have been started 20 years ago with Amadou Diallo.
Yeah,
you know?
Sure.
Because I've been feeling this way about Black Lives Matter for 20 years. I knew Amadou Diallo. I didn't know him well personally, but I was married to a West African, and they were all kind of in the same...
community, yeah.
Yeah, same community. And what happened to Amadou Diallo back then was just absolutely tragic. It was awful. And these new things that are happening, it's just like, it's like I've been feeling this way forever, and so I don't understand how somebody can't support Black Lives Matter, but half of my high school friends don't. Mm. They think that it's some sort of terrorist organization that's trying to ruin people's property, because they're not around black people, and they're not seeing
how... You don't have any real reference.
You're right.
Yeah.
they just go by what they're told. And it's very unfortunate because when you get people that aren't in these more urban areas, they can't firsthand see what's happening in the urban areas, and they rely upon what they're told. Media understands this, and they target those people.
Exactly. And Trump built on that.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. If Biden gets into office, I'm hoping that we'll put a lot of pressure on him to address a lot of stuff that we're not satisfied with before Trump was in office.
Yeah.
You know, to not only clean up, but to, like, move things along in this country. Oh, yeah. And this is Florence, by the way. She likes it when I pet her. I'll be right back.